see Rob and Susan. We've never had a good plan for meeting Susan. And though we've known her for a lot of years, through her husband and through the work that's been done here. And I know that you know the congregation, how important you are to have them. And we have known you because of them. They've spoken so kindly of you over the years and had wonderful things to say about this congregation. So we really were anxious to meet you. And certainly, I'm glad for the opportunity to be here. I'll do my best this week to make sure that I honor God's word and say all these little things God revealed in the way that He intended for them to be revealed. Obviously, we'll make some personal applications. I'll make sure that you know that there are personal applications that I have made of those things. And there's a distinction between what God says and sometimes what how we might apply it. And so if there's anything that I misapply, then certainly I'm dependent upon you as my brothers and sisters in Christ to correct those things. Not somewhere down the way, but before I leave here this week, because I want to go to heaven more than anything else in this world. I don't want to miss it. And so if I miss something, I want you to point that out to me, and I'll correct it today, not tomorrow, because I want to go to heaven. I hope that's your desire. I hope that's what our time together will allow all of us to do as we strive to be pleased in Him. What I will attempt to do this week is to condense down into a handful of lessons what it takes me 5 to 7 weeks to accomplish in premarital counseling with couples who ask me if I would perform their ceremony. I don't perform any ceremonies any longer unless they agree to have at least 5 weeks with me in premarital counseling. Just don't do it. It's a very celebratory time. I'm always honored when people ask me, but I've been at this work for 32 years. It's serious work. Now, I've seen people get all excited about getting married and make no preparation to do so. They don't understand what it is. And then I counsel with them with issues in their life that never really should have been issues in their life. And so I want to do it ahead of time. I want to talk about what God intends for them to be as individuals and what He expects of them and their roles that they're about to assume in this marital relationship and how that would influence the world, because we represent God as husband and wife in the standpoint of nobody understands Christ's relationship with the church unless they can see that demonstrated in our marriages. And so it becomes a very serious matter to me. When I was at Dublin, I shared with Bible class where, you know, people came to me with all kinds of issues in their life, and I could quote scriptures to them, but I didn't have much experience. I was a young man, and I didn't have much life experience, and so I went back to school to get my degree just out of self-defense. I just knew I was going to push someone over the edge. There were some distraught people that came to me, and I thought, I don't have a clue how to take them away or emotional. And get them coherent enough to really hear what God had to say and do what God expects them to do. They're just too emotional in context. So I never really intended to be a counselor. I just wanted to be a better preacher and to do a better job at what I was doing. But once you get that training, folks tell them, you know, they say, you know, Brother Martin, he's got counseling degree. So the next thing you know, folks say, Brother Martin, I'm not a counselor. I don't know that I have a really good grasp of that, but you're trying to help more folks. And I had the good pleasure of working with Biblical School Preaching, the school that you supported for a great number of years. You have a student there now, Emmanuel Jordan, who's been scared out of his wits here in this new country with all these strange folks and people like you who loved him, and you sent him off up there to all these people who've got these serious faces and all these assignments. But in that context, I've had the good pleasure of trying to instill in the hearts of these preachers who are preparing to go out into the field a few more things that they can use in local work that I didn't have when I started local work, so that they will know how to help folks and know when they can help folks and they need to find other folks who can help folks. You know, we do that when it comes to medical doctors, don't we? I know I'm not a medical doctor. You know what I'm not going to do? They try to pretend like I can take care of your medical needs. I'm not trying to do that. sometimes emotionally we have that same kind of maturity to say, some things are a little beyond us. And leaders in the church need to know that and say, here are the things we need to do as shepherds and how we need to help folks. But these are some things that I really don't know how to identify. So what I'll share with you this week is, here's what I do with couples. I'm giving you this background so you don't think when I'm talking real fast and I'm getting all excited about these things, that if you slow down, you know. There's a lot of information that I want to share, at least a template of things with you. So when I leave this week, you'll have things that you can really, really use in your personal life and in your marriage, in your families, and in the congregation. It'll help you be who God wants you to be. And for you to accomplish what God wants you to accomplish. You can build on those things. And these are just basic things that you'll need to do your own work on. But in those 5 weeks, I made sure, here's what happens. Is every week, they have to decide, the very first session, their first homework assignment, is they have to go home and take that first lesson I give them, and they have to decide, a couple of us, these two people who want to get married, they have to decide what time of day they're going to meet for 10 minutes. They take longer than they want to, but it has to be 10 minutes. Where they take the lesson I've given them, they read a paragraph, they read the whole thing if they want to. But they have to read at least a paragraph of it, they have to look up the verses, they have to talk about what they read, then they have to go to God and pray with my wife for us today, pray together, and they talk. Same time every day. Can't be 2 o'clock on Tuesday, 7 o'clock on Wednesday, you know, you don't do that. You find a time when you would normally talk. They're not married yet, so they may have to do this on the phone. But it's going to be the same time every day. And they're going to read that information, and they're going to talk about it. What I'm doing is creating in them, if they do that for 5 weeks every day, think about it. Every day, same time every day. They sit down, they pause, they have to have the TV turned off, they can't answer the phone. I say, if it's an emergency, somebody else will call 911. Don't worry about it. For 10 minutes, unplug from it, focus on what I want you to focus on. Here's what I know. I know God is speaking to them every day, and I know what He's saying to them. Because I've assigned the verses. I know what God's saying to that couple every single day. I know what they're talking about every day. Instead of saying, you know, y'all need to talk about how serious marriage is, and y'all need to find out, you know, really what you want to be in life, and it may get general, and they say, what are we talking about? No, I tell them what to talk about. I know what they're talking about every day, the same time every day. I know because I'm assigned. So if they say, we don't communicate very well, I know what they're not communicating very well about. Because I've assigned it. Here's what else I know. I know they're talking to God every single day. The same time every day. I know what they're talking to God. I don't just say, you know, you need to be prayerful kind of people. You need to pray every day. You pray every day? Yeah, we pray every day. What do you pray about? Well, just God is good, God is great. But what do you pray about? He is good. He is good. How do you know that? What demonstrates that for you? How would you express your appreciation for His goodness and His greatness? So I know what they're saying to God every day because they have to pray to God about what they're talking about. And so they're talking to God about, we heard what you said. We paid attention to how we are applied as individuals and how we'll have to apply this marriage. We heard you. And you are good. And you are great. You have told us how to live. You provide us with so many blessings in this relationship. We can help each other. One day live with the eternal. You see, those things don't just happen. You have to nurture those things. You have to develop those things. Now, if they do that every day, the same time every day, from 5 to 7 weeks, you know what happens after they say, I do? They have a habit. Every day that time of day, they're going to at least have a twin to say, we're supposed to read something today, aren't we? We're in Brother Martin's lessons, you know? Maybe they'll take that Bible lesson they had at worship service and they take it home and say, we're going to study this together. We're going to let God speak to us. And that's what we're going to talk about this week. And that way they start digesting, not what they hear from the sermon every time, and not what the Bible class teacher said, but they are participants in the process. They've learned how to do that, and they take everything God said seriously. That's what we're talking about. And here's where I start with them. I start with them in premarital counseling way back before, whatever attracted you to each other. You see, what they're reading about is they go back to the first few chapters of Genesis, and they get to really see the beginning. But they get to look at it from the standpoint of, we're about to duplicate what God demonstrated for us in the beginning. What was it that we saw? We read those passages about God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. So they start with an image, God's image. About what he's about to do will demonstrate who he is, what his character is, what his holiness is all about, what his compassion and care is all about. This crowning part of his creation, when he's done all these other things and all these other days, he said, now pay attention. Let us. This is the Godhead here. Let us make man in our image. And the first thing this couple gets to see is God made these individuals. This is not some kind of blurred, not sure if it's man or woman. It's a man and a woman. And God made them. And here's what I work with them on to see. They have to look at some words and some definitions. And one of those words, and the reason I'm spending a little more time on this is the part we miss. All of us miss in the church. They spent some time looking at what the individual is all about. You see, marriages and homes are made up of individuals. If the individual material is not what it ought to be, then the marriage and the home is not going to be what it ought to be. What do we mean, ought to be? It ought to be in God's image. And if you've got two individuals who are in God's image, guess what kind of relationship you're going to have? A relationship, that's the way God intended it. You see, the first thing they have to see is that this relationship has to be made by God. We say, this is a match made in heaven. Well, that's true. If you're going to get married, it ought to be a match made in heaven. In his image. Two people who look like God looks, spiritually speaking. Who behave God's like God behaved, spiritually speaking. Who want to accomplish what God intended to be accomplished, spiritually speaking. And if that's the case, guess what you're going to have? Exactly what God intended for you to have in that relationship. Oh, not what you dreamed about it, not what everybody else is talking about it, and not what TV advertises. You're going to have what God intended you to have. It's going to be full and meaningful and happy. So they have to define a word. That word, single. We use it all the time. How many singles do you have in your congregation? You see, when you go back to Genesis chapter, the last part of chapter 1, chapter 2, you see what single really means. If you go to Webster, you have to get down to about the seventh definition before you get the Bible definition of single. It means whole, unique, complete. You see, God formed man from the dust of the earth. And he breathed in his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. We know he created Adam first, and so here he had this male that God had created. He was whole. Emotionally whole, physically whole, spiritually whole, because God made him, wasn't he? He was whole. A complete, unique person. We even acknowledge his uniqueness. Adam. First man, Adam, unique. He allowed him to see all the rest of the creation, marched all the creatures before Adam, allowed him to see that he was the only one of his kind. These are not accidental things that you read about it. I wonder why God did that. Why didn't he just create Adam to start with? And Adam had to absorb this being the only one of his kind. Nothing else like him. That's got to sink in. No other creature like him. Why? Because he's made God's image. And then he causes that to be absorbed. But these other creatures are paired off and they can reproduce. And he's the only one of his kind. This is serious business, isn't it? So he makes Adam fall asleep. That's not accidental either. He doesn't need Adam's advice. He's like, wait a minute. What are you doing here? What kind of woman are you going to make me? Now, let me tell you what I want. No, you see, this is a unique being made in God's image. And God takes him to sleep. God makes him another unique being. When Adam wakes up, he had no say-so in what he looked like, did he? What color eyes does he have? What color is her hair? Well, you know, I'm just really not attracted to blonde. No, none of those superficial things. This is another whole, complete, unique being. Adam recognized it immediately, didn't he? He said, she is now bone of my bone, flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman because she was taken by man. These two unique individuals will set the template for what God intended for the marital relationship to be. Now, this is not just nice stories to read our children. Adults better spend some time there and say, what do you see? We see that image of that uniqueness of that individual. Here's what we've done in the church, and I'm as guilty as anybody. But we've taken that word, single, that allows us to look at ourselves and make sure that we're right with God. And we've confused it and said, if you're not married, then there's something wrong with you. And we're going to have this pool of people in the church, and we're going to have a single group, and you better get married. And so pick out somebody from this group. This is our singles group. Well, that's not a Bible definition of single. Well, God said it wasn't good for man to be single. Never, ever said that. God made you single. Adam never ceased being Adam. He never became Eve. Eve never became Adam. We acknowledge our uniqueness by saying Adam and Eve. That's the context that we live out. Here's what he did say. And it's got not good for man to be alone. Alone means solitary. Separate. Was it good for man to be the only one of his kind? No one to communicate with? No one to really reflect to him the image of God and for them to demonstrate then God's blessings and care of their lives? No way to see him all by himself. Those are really insightful things that too often we meet. We get caught up in all the technical part of it and we lose sight of the beauty of it. Just as a matter of humor, before we move to our next application of the principle we talked about this week, but got to get that part right. Had a man called the church building there at Cordova when I was preaching there. He said, just moved to the area, you're looking for a church home. How big a single group do you have? Well, Cordova's about 200 in membership, so at the time, a little better than that. And so, you know, we've got 200 members. I said, about 200. Knowing my definition of single, holding the Bible definition of single, all the Christians, they're going to stand before God and answer for their singleness. I said, about 200. He said, wow. You know, you can hear it in his voice. That's the place I want to be. I got 200 folks to choose from. You know, I'm unmarried. The church keeps telling me, get married, get married, get married. No, get single, get single, get single. You be whole and unique in your relationship with God, and you're going to run right smack dab in somebody who's whole and unique and busy in the Lord's service. And then you're going to be like Adam and Eve when you wake up. And God gets through with things. You wake up, it will be a match made in heaven. Because you're doing God. And it becomes natural. It was natural out of Eve, wasn't it? Well, choices made. They didn't say, "This is it." She did. You don't have that conversation, do you? Wow. God made both of them. When they saw each other, they saw what God intended all along. That's why I try to get couples to see before they get married. So when those hard times comes, they just hold on to their singleness and say, "Look, have you ever just paid attention to the singleness of the scriptures?" I'm talking about singleness from the standpoint of how it applies to us. Listen, seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. How do you do that? How do you do that? You have to do that as an individual, don't you? You have to determine whether or not you're going to seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, don't you? That's a uniqueness. You may choose to do it, I may choose not to do it. When you think about that and you contemplate the seriousness of those things, what about your obedience? Jesus even described the singleness of it in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 21. "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he that doeth the will of my Father who art in heaven." Who is that? Individual. Not everyone that says they have a relationship with God has a relationship with God. How is that determined? Individual obedience. Singleness. You've got to be whole and unique in your relationship with God. You're the only one that can decide, as we talked about in Bible class, how this purchase space is going to be used, whether or not you're going to clutter it with other things or not. You have to decide, and you can't just declare yourself saved. You have to make sure that you're saved by being obedient to the Lord's word. Listen to this individual application of Scripture. Examine yourselves whether you be in faith. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. How do you do that? When I look in the mirror, guess who's there? Just me. Now I may let my mind wander and think, you know, I wish this, or boy, that person's harmed me. But when I look in that mirror, I'm reflecting back at me, it's me. So if I've got a frown on my face, what's that all about? I've decided to be unhappy about something. If I have a smile on my face, what am I happy about? Those are serious matters. Examine yourself whether you be in the faith. If we get that part right, then we begin to be able to handle issues that come up within our relationship, because I have to decide, okay, how should I behave here? And what should I say here? And what should I do here? And when I don't understand singleness, and I think that just means unmarried, and I think getting married is going to solve all my problems, guess what? Ain't gonna happen. Those are people I see all the time who have that image of marriage. But boy, if they get equipped saying, "Oh, I gotta be right with God. I gotta be in his image. I gotta make sure that I keep myself examined." What about this passage? We use it all the time. But listen to the singleness of the application. Study to show God himself. A workman that needed not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of the truth. How do you do that? That's very individual, isn't it? You may desire for yourself the scripture reading this morning. No greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. What if they don't? No greater sorrow than that. Why wouldn't they? Singleness. Have to decide whether you make application of those things you've been taught about. Serious matter, huh? Parents may be faithful. Children may choose not to. Bible's filled with those kind of secular things taking place. Faithful generation, unfaithful generation. What happens? Somewhere along the way, people fail to be whole, single, and unique. Their image and their relationship with God. I don't allow those couples over the 5 to 7 weeks to get that out of their minds. Because if they can really understand who they're supposed to be with the Lord, then guess how they're going to treat each other? Exactly the way the Lord intended them to treat each other. If they don't get that right with the Lord, like Adam absorbing the fact that he's the only one of his kind and that God had all these other creatures and he really had to absorb that. No one else like me. And then when he opens his eyes after God putting him to sleep, someone like him, reflecting back the image of God's purity, God's holiness. Now that's a match made in heaven. How about this passage? See if the seriousness of the application of singleness holds your attention this week. We shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ to give an answer of the deeds done in this body, according to that which we've done, whether it be good or whether it be evil. Guess who is the only one in this body? Now, I counsel some people sometimes who think there are more people in their body than one. Now, I'm not making fun of them, and we think, well, wait a minute. That's not quite right. No, but there are not multiple people in there now. What's that multiple personality thing all about? So we see the abnormality of that, don't we? And yet, when it comes to spiritual application, we don't always see the seriousness of being conscious of standing before the judgment seat of Christ. And we're going to be the only one that we answer for. No mama, no daddy, no husband, no wife. No son, no daughter. Just me. How whole and unique can I remain in the image of God? Have I marred that image? Have I blamed my less than singleness upon somebody? You see, those are things that are just inescapable. And yet we've read that creation story, and we even say, was it good for man to be alone? But we don't understand what was good about man, about woman, and that first couple. They were in God's image, uniquely so. Created full grown. We'll talk about more this evening about the application of that as far as being full grown. Making sure that we understand that there is a responsibility in our part before we say I do and begin our giving life to a relationship, giving birth to a marriage, that we are the spiritual, genetic, whole, unique individual that we are. So that relationship looks like God always intended for it to look. Those will be inescapable requirements. Ingredients of a godly home. What about you this morning? Just you. Not your husband, not your wife. Not your son, not your daughter. Not your mother, not your father. Not the elders, not the preacher. Not your neighbor, just you. If the trumpet were to sound, if the Lord were to return, and you stand before his judgment seat, just you. Are you comfortable with your uniqueness, your wholeness, your singleness? You see, I can be aggravated with my wife and spend days justifying myself for my aggravation. Doesn't change a thing. I might say, you know, so-and-so treated me this way, and that's why I don't attend Bible class, and I'm not involved in the church, and I begin to make all these excuses about what other people did or didn't do. And when I stand before God, he's going to say, what did you do? That was my space that I purchased with my son's blood. I intended to do powerful work there, my will. I intended for you to shine a light in a crooked and perverse and dark room, and you so cluttered my space, you were no longer in my image. Now that's serious, isn't it? Jerry Martin is the only one that's going to be conscious of standing before the judgment seat of Christ. There'll be throng. Everybody who's ever lived will be there. But you know who I'm going to be conscious of? I'm going to be conscious of Jerry Martin and my singleness. My holiness, my uniqueness. What does it look like in the world? If you're here, not a child of God, You're not in the image of God. And we're all the children of God. We are all right God this way. By faith in Christ Jesus. For a bit of us are baptized into Christ and put on Christ. No more Jew and Greek. No more